You guys can still talk. We're okay with that. Friendship, fellowship, working together. Great to be gathered together. Welcome to those who are watching online. Great and mighty is the Lord our God. Very familiar one for us. You can sit or stand, whatever you're comfortable with. Here we go.
Great and mighty is the Lord our God. Great and
had a new grandson, so I haven't had that granddaughter, sorry, I think my wife is here to correct me, granddaughter, I haven't held this little thing yet because I'm afraid I'm going to break it, but Teresa's had a number of times holding this, That last line is what I've been thinking about this week. This child can face uncertain days because Jesus lives. And we live in uncertain days. No two ways about that. But this child, my grandchild, my children, can face those uncertain days because we know that Jesus is the one who is King. We know there's all kinds of upheaval and change and everything else going on. But we know that we have a King who is still in ultimate control. And He is the one that watches over our lives. When we are His people, He is the one that cares for us. So I think that we should sing that second verse again. How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy she gives. Can I take you that day? Have greater than the God assuring this child can face uncertain days because He lives. can gather here today. We thank you for your presence here with us. Lord, as we just sang that song, I think about the Holy Spirit and how your Spirit comes and pours into our lives, invades our hearts in a powerful and wonderful way. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, that your Spirit is here in some wonderful, mysterious way today. We pray, Lord, that you would speak into our hearts. And we know, Lord, that you're not limited by time and distance. So those who are joining in online, Lord, may they sense the power and presence of your Spirit as well. We thank you for the reality that you are our friend, you are our God, and you are the one that loves our souls. So we pray, Lord, that everything we do and everything we say today would bring you honor and thanks and praise. Jesus, we pray this in your powerful name. Amen. You may be seated. Well, just a couple of announcements, a couple of things that are happening in our local church here over the next little while. We're looking forward this week to getting started with our children's program, which is on Wednesday nights at 6 to about 7:15. We call it Naz Kids, and everybody is, well, just check with Wendy or Bella or Nancy as far as whether your kids can come. We're kind of limiting it a little bit. We don't want 200 kids. Well, we like 200 kids. We just don't have the people for 200 kids. So that is this Wednesday, starting this Wednesday. Also this Wednesday, we're starting Locker Room, which is for our teens. And usually we go with ages 12 to about, 20, I guess, 21. Teens are supposed to go to 30, according to the Nazarene rules. So I don't know what age limit we'll stop it at. But we have a couple of new helpers, leaders. So Cole and Madison are going to be helping. And I'm just going to sit back and not do anything, Cole. I'm just going to relax. You're going to do all the work, right? Not just nod your head. No, he's not nodding his head. But it should be fun. And we look forward just to getting together with them. And again, we just enjoy being with our teens and our youth. And so we'll look forward to that. A few other things in September, October coming up, we're hoping to have, just how things are going to work, we're not sure, but we're hoping to have our seniors lunch, 60 plus. That'll usually happens the second Thursday of the month, and we'll have a men's breakfast. And I keep on hearing rumors that Bella's going to make Raymond cook for a women's breakfast, but that hasn't come yet, so we'll see what happens there. Just enjoy being together and enjoy worshiping the Lord together. Thanks as always for tithes and offerings. We appreciate that. It allows us to keep the doors open and keep things running. And it's a way for not only you to bless the church, but I believe that God blesses us through that as well. We're going to sing together some more. And again, if you know these songs, just join in. If not, just enjoy and learn them as we go. This is a great song. We've sang this one for a couple of years now, I think. And it talks about the amazing grace of God and how His love is just what sets us free, makes us who we're supposed to be.
Makes the orphan a son.
Video this week. I don't know if you know the group King and Country, great Christian, I don't know, rock country group. I'm not sure where to describe them. They have a new song out, and I think it's just been out a couple days. And what a great message to the song. The name of the song and the message of the song is God is with us. God is with us. And And I was thinking, that's really powerful to get kind of our minds and our hearts around. That no matter what we're going through and what we're dealing with, God is with us. Amen. He is the one who walks with us. You know, the trouble is, I was talking with someone today or this week and talking about the spiritual part of our lives. And oftentimes, that spiritual part is kind of invisible. We don't really see it. We don't perceive it. But that doesn't mean that God isn't with us. Even if we don't sense His presence there, He is still with us. And so, I was thinking about this song through the week too. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. What does that mean to have eyes? We don't have eyes in our physical hearts, but what it means is our spirits, our souls. Just to open the eyes so that we can see what God is doing in and around us, for us to be able to perceive that. I know there is people who are probably more spiritual conscious than I am, for sure. Sometimes God needs to hit me with a brick to get my attention, but still He is there, and He is the one that speaks and moves in our hearts. So as you sing this song, sing it as a prayer. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes, because I want to see You. I want to see how You're working in my life, how You're working in the lives of people around us. Let's sing this together.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see You. I want to see You. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart.
Praying to this wonderful and holy God, the one who continues to work in our hearts and lives, and continue to pray for those around us. Pray for Jeannie, your operations this week coming? Yeah, so we want to, sorry? Tomorrow at 8 o'clock. So remember, tomorrow at 8 o'clock, pray for Jeannie. Pray that all goes well. pray that God will continue to work in her, body and bring healing there. We continue to pray for Linda's family, Blake's family, and pray that God would bring strength and hope and comfort as they grieve their loss. And I know there's many others that need our prayers and need God to continue to work in our hearts and lives. And so we want to lift them up as well as a church family and as a community. Yeah, nice purse there, by the way. Nice carrier. So let's pray together and talk to the Lord together. Father, we thank you that you love us and you care about what is happening in our lives. We pray, Lord, that you would continue to work in our families and in our community. We pray for Canada and ask, Lord, that you would continue to work here. And Lord, pray for the new government as they kind of get reestablished. And Lord, we just ask that you would give the leaders wisdom and guidance, and Lord, help them to understand that ultimately you are the King, and that we are to bow our knee and give our allegiance to you. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that you continue to work in the midst of our circumstances and situations, no matter what we're dealing with and what we're going through. You are our battle partner. You are the one who comes alongside us. And Lord, we pray for those who are struggling with health issues today. We pray for Jeannie for this operation tomorrow. Lord, we'd love it if you'd heal her before that. We don't know your will in this, but Lord, we pray for her healing. Continue to pray for that and ask, Lord, that you would move in her body and bring healing and wholeness there. We pray, Lord, for those who are grieving, and we know there are many in our community that are struggling with loss. And we do pray for their families. We pray for Blake's family. We pray for your strength and comfort in the midst of their loss. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, that we have this hope that if we are your children, there is life after life. And we are grateful, Lord Jesus, that you give us this true hope, this eternal hope. And you're the one that helps us to discover what life is all about, but also, Lord, we spend an eternity in your presence and knowing you more. So we thank you, Lord Jesus, that we can commit each other to you. We pray, Lord, for those who are dealing with struggles, dealing with challenges, whether it's relationships, Lord, whether it's addictions, Lord, whether it's finances, whether it's in families. Lord, we know there are a lot of, I'm going to say, extra stresses and strains on people's lives right now. And so we pray for each other. We pray that you would give us wisdom. You would give us guidance. You would give us strength. And you would help us to understand what you are calling us to be in the middle of all that's going on. We thank you, Jesus, that you are real and that you speak into our hearts and you help us to face each day as it comes. And for that, we are grateful. So we thank you, Lord Jesus, again, for those who are here, those who are watching online. We pray, Lord, that your continued presence and your power would be showing up in their lives. And we pray, Lord Jesus, that you would find us faithful and true to who you called us to be. Father, we just want to allow a moment of quiet this morning, a time of silence in our busy lives. A time maybe to think about you, a time maybe to lift a prayer to you as well. Pray together the prayer that Jesus taught the first disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory,
forever and ever.
A little dry this morning. Well, it's been another busy week. I'm not sure about you guys, but it seems to have just kind of zipped past. Until today, the weather has been really nice through the week. I said to someone a couple days ago that summer has finally come to the island. It's been really nice. Here in Canada, and I know there is those who watch from around the world, another federal election has kind of come and gone, and if I was to kind of sum up that election in one sentence, it would be, we spent a whole lot of money and nothing changed. I'm trying not to be cynical about it, but did the election do any good? You know, anyway, just kind of wondering about that. The potato harvest here in the island has also started in earnest this week, and I am praying that it goes well for our farmers and the crops are substantial. And they pay well. There's a lot of trucks on the road, and it's great to see the machines in the fields digging and gathering up the crop. I hear a lot of farmers are struggling to get help, and I was kind of tempted to get a truck license myself and do some driving. I was thinking that might be a bit of fun to do that. Well, this week, as I was thinking about driving, I was remembering an adventure that we had a few years back. I'm not sure if it was this time of year or if it was spring, but it was a short time after Teresa and I had moved here to the island, and we were out for a drive. I still had my white cargo van back then, and we were exploring and looking around the countryside. Now, Teresa sometimes just likes to try a road and see where it goes. And so I was kind of letting her take the lead and give directions, and I was driving and enjoying the scenery. Well, she chose a road to explore. Now, I now know that it is the road that leads to the beautiful community of Hebron. And if you know the road, there is some absolutely gorgeous scenery of the shore and the ocean as you travel along it. But this road turns from pavement to clay once you get a certain distance along it. And I can remember looking at that dirt section of the road, knowing that it had been wet for the last week or so, and thinking, not sure this is a good idea. But as I said, Teresa was doing the leading and directing, and she said, it can't be that bad. It can't be that bad. Well, we got a short way in, and the van was sinking deeper and deeper and deeper in the mud. The ruts were like 2 feet deep, and I finally stuck the vehicle in reverse and slowly crawled out of the predicament that we found ourselves in. I'm thinking if we'd gone any further, well, the van would probably still be there, and half buried and no longer white, but mostly red from the beautiful island mud. Not a good idea to drive on a clay road in a two-wheel drive vehicle after you've had a whole bunch of precipitation. It made me realize that leadership is important. And I'm not knocking Teresa, because it is fun to explore. But leadership and knowing where you're going is crucial. This is also true in our lives and true in the church. The question of why we're here and where we are going is crucial in this time and in this place. Jesus was near the beginning of the time on planet Earth where he was healing and teaching and doing some amazing miracles. I want to check out how Matthew describes what was happening. Here's what he says, starting at verse 35 of chapter 9. It says, Jesus traveled through all the towns and villages of that area, teaching in the synagogues, which is a Jewish church, and announcing the good news about the kingdom. And he healed every kind of disease and illness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them, because they were confused and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. And he said to his disciples, the harvest is great, but the workers are few. So pray to the Lord of the harvest, who is in charge of the harvest, and ask him to send more workers into his fields. Now, I've heard this Bible section used a number of times at missions convention and other meetings, but I think it's totally relevant to where we are at today. Just think about it. Was there ever a time when people were more confused and fearful and some seeming to run like a sheep without a shepherd? Was there ever a time when the good news of Jesus rescuing us from sin and fear was needed more? Was there ever a greater opportunity to tell people that Jesus can heal and restore and bring peace and hope into your life? So where are the people of God in the middle of this? Are we leading or are we surviving? Have we so become so concerned with ourselves and preserving what we have, the reason why we're here, has all but faded to way down on the list and lost its urgency? And I'm talking to myself here as well as others. When I was thinking about this, it reminded me of a story. On a dangerous sea coast where shipwrecks often occur, there was once a crude little life-saving station. The building was just a hut, and there was only one boat. But the few devoted members kept a constant watch over the sea, and with no thought for themselves, went out day and night tirelessly searching for the lost. And some of those who were saved and various others of the surrounding area wanted to become associated with the station and gave of their time and money and efforts for the support of its work. New boats were bought and new crews trained. The little life-saving station grew. Well, some members of the life-saving station were unhappy with the building, that it was so crude and poorly equipped, and they felt like a more comfortable place should be provided as the first refuge for those saved from the sea. They replaced the emergency cots with beds and put better furniture in the enlarged building. Now the life-saving station became a popular gathering place for its members, and they decorated it beautifully and furnished it exquisitely because they used it as sort of a club. Fewer members were now interested in going to sea on life-saving missions, so they hired lifeboat crews to do this work. The life-saving motif still prevailed in this club's decoration, and there was a miniature lifeboat in the room where the club initiations were held. About this time, a large ship was wrecked off the coast, and the hired crews brought in boatloads of cold and wet and half-drowned people. They were dirty. They were sick. And some of them were different than the members in culture and race. The beautiful new club was in chaos. So the leaders of the life-saving club immediately had a shower house built outside of the club where victims of shipwreck could be cleaned up before coming inside. At the next meeting, there was a split in the membership. Most of the members wanted to stop the club's life-saving activities, since they were unpleasant and a hindrance to the normal social life of the club. Some members insisted upon life-saving as their primary purpose, and pointed out that they were still called a life-saving station. But they were finally voted down and told that if they wanted to save the lives of all various kinds of people who were shipwrecked in these waters, they could begin their own life-saving station down the coast. As I read this story, it kind of made me a bit uncomfortable, because it kind of describes how some of our churches are operating. We're a lot like this life-saving club. It seems to me that church can easily follow the path of comfort and so much enjoying our own time with each other that we forget the reason we are really here. We are here to spread the good news that we are not alone, that God, our Creator, loves us so much that He sent His one and only Son to rescue us from sin, from guilt, and to fill our hearts and lives with His presence and His power. We are here to let people know that there is hope. There's hope for a future filled with meaning, hope for a life after death, and hope for a relationship with God that is glorious and real. We have come to know the truth that Jesus died and rose from the grave, and there is nothing or no one who can stop you and I from discovering this incredible relationship that we can have with the Creator of the universe. The problem is that the Church of Jesus, God's people, have become way too much like the farmer who spent all his time repairing his equipment and not getting crops out of the ground that, and then was surprised when the bank came to repossess the farm and gave it to someone who would produce a harvest. I'm wondering if it's time to move from focusing on discipleship to one of gathering in the harvest, to get out in the middle of the storms that surround us and rescue some people and help them find their way to hope and wholeness. Just think if someone had not done that for us. We would be far from God and not knowing what direction to go in. I hope that there is a holy discontent in your soul when you realize that there are people all around us that God is trying to reach and rescue, but He has no one willing to take the risk and give their lives to bring in the harvest. Maybe farmers and business people who are struggling to find help are starting to understand how God feels when He says there is no laborers for His harvest. And we're not talking soybeans and spuds here, we're talking souls for eternity. When the Bible was written, there was no chapters or verses, so the next few lines are part of the moments that we read earlier. And here's what happens after Jesus said, "So pray to the Lord who is in charge of the harvest and ask Him to send more workers into the field." It says, "Then Jesus called His 12 disciples together and gave them authority to cast out evil spirits and to heal every kind of disease and illness." And then a little further in verse 7, He gives them these instructions. He says, go, and announce to them that the kingdom of heaven is near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cure those with leprosy, cast out demons. Just as freely as you have received, give. So these words for praying for workers for the harvest that Jesus said are not just inspiring words, but Jesus follows them up with selecting and equipping and sending out. Did you notice that He also gives authority? Jesus gathers His disciples, His people together and gives them authority to be agents of the kingdom of God and then sends them out. I want you to notice something else here as well. This was near the beginning of when Jesus did His walking around ministry, not after the disciples had been with Him a full 3 years. These guys didn't have it all together. They didn't have everything figured out. But they did have a strong connection with Jesus and were following Him wholeheartedly. Jesus called them to follow Him like He does with us. He gave them a mission to tell their friends and neighbors that the kingdom was here, like He does with us. He gave them authority to act as his representatives, with the Spirit of God empowering them like he does with us. I don't know if you realize this, but those 12 disciples are not here anymore. They are dead and buried, gone to be with Jesus in the place we call heaven. So does Jesus still call people to follow him? Does he still invite men and women, boys and girls, to be his agents and representatives in this world, in this time? Is he still looking for people to whom he will give his authority to be his champions and to share the good news of God's kingdom, to heal the sick and to raise the dead, to deliver the incredible truth that Jesus died for our sin and guilt and we can be set free and whole? You think he is? If you believe he's still calling us to this, then why not you? Or are we going to be like the members of the life-saving station that were so occupied with friendships and comfortableness of being with like-minded people that we've left the essence of who we are and the mission that we're called to? Are you and I willing to face the storms, risk our time and energy and reputation to fulfill the mission that Jesus gave to all of his followers? Are you and I willing to live in a way that brings honor to the one who is sending us and who put his life on the line so that we can put our life on the line as well? I think this is worth giving your life to. This will impact the world and impact eternity. Jesus said, just as freely as you have received, give. And we understand that each of us, each of our lives is a gift given by God. And him rescuing us from sin and granting forgiveness, that's a gift from God. The one we follow, Jesus, laid down his life for our salvation and rescue. A true gift from God. Can we do any less than share this good news of God's kingdom with those he puts in our path? Can we do any less but seek out those who God is calling to himself? Freely you have received, now freely give of your time and energy and resources. I believe that if we do this, he will empower us with his authority to be his agents and ambassadors to the hurting and struggling people all around us. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you for your love for us, how powerful it is, how it's changed my life. Lord, help me to share that with others in a way that they are able to see who you are. Lord, sometimes I feel like I'm just really limited with the words that I say about this amazing relationship that we can have with you, how it transforms us, changes our hearts, makes us new people, takes away the fear, takes away the guilt. And Lord, you forgive us of our sins because of what you did. Grateful, Lord, for this relationship that we can have with you. But help us, Lord, to share it by our actions, by our words, by those around us. Lord, you know there are people, even in our community here, that are looking for something more. And Jesus, you are that more. So help us, Lord, to be able to effectively help them find it. We thank you, Jesus, for who you are and that you continue to work with your people. We thank you for this in your name. Amen. There's a chorus we sing sometimes here. kind of must be from the last line of that verse. Freely, freely you have received, freely, freely give. So we're going to sing that together. Presence upon each person, upon each family gathered here, and I pray this in the name and the authority of Jesus Christ. Amen.